What did y'all think? Carly just said to me, she goes, man, I don't understand how these guys come up with this stuff. Now, first, let me preface. If you are a writer or you enjoy spoken word or you do that yourself, do not be offended, okay? These are merely just funny videos. No worries. But funny story about it. Anyways, when I was your age in youth group, I had a friend who, much like the guy, the bald guy with the long beard, like, you could kind of tell, like, if he actually tried, he could be actually really good at it. Like, he was going pretty hard, and I was like, oh, that's actually kind of cool. But I had a friend in middle school, or high school, Jacob Bentley. Jacob, if you're watching this, I don't know if he ever will. But Jacob was also a buddy of mine. He went to college. We overlapped for a year there. But we were in youth group. Spoken word was just kind of coming out as like a big thing. And a large majority of people were confused by why it was a thing. Because, remember, I'm 28, okay? So this is 10 to 15 years ago, all right? This is not the climate now. But back in the day, it was kind of like, this is kind of stupid. Why is this becoming such a fad, all right? And so my buddy Jacob was like trying to just mock it as much as possible. He made the most beautiful spoken word about McDonald's. And I need to see if there's a video out in the world anywhere, because it is truly a work of masterpiece. Like, and I know he was doing it just to make fun of the whole idea, but it was like really good. Same type of thing. Like, if he actually put in some effort and tried and took it seriously, like, he could be going places, right? And then I had another buddy. Yesterday I was out at Beulah Beach. How many of you have been to Beulah Beach? Whoop, whoop. I went out there yesterday for the day to help my buddy do some work for the camp for their summer set design for the stage and stuff, and that was a lot of fun. But where was I going with Beulah Beach? Oh, my buddy that I was helping, he does actual spoken words. I think I've shown – have I shown any of Aaron's in here? I may have shown – I showed it at either at Winter Retreat last year or Summer Revival last year. But he did a whole, like, unity through diversity with Pastor Calvin. I showed that one, didn't I? I don't know. But anyways, lots of good spoken words out there. Those guys are fantastic. When I saw this, I watched it a couple times today because I was, like, picking up on things every other time, and I thought it was pretty good. Was it, like, did you guys think it was funny, or are you offended by it? Funny? Offended? Okay, that's good. I'm glad you guys are learning. Wait, was your hand up being, you're offended, or you were waiting to, oh. All right, right on. Okay, now when somebody can actually go off on Adam and Eve in the garden and throw in that many fruit references, let me tell you, there's a real gift of talent there. Why not? Exactly. It was all... really actually all about Jeffrey Bezos, yeah. If we come down to it, you know. So all you Amazon shoppers, beware. Hello? Do you want me to answer it? I'm just kidding. I was hoping it was a phone call. I've been getting a lot of phone calls lately of random people, and I was on the phone. When did that guy call that I talked to, Carly? 9 p.m. Was it last night? It was last night. Let me tell you guys, I'm exhausted today. I'll be honest. I'm absolutely zonked. When I have to drive for most of the day, like I did yesterday, takes all the energy out of me. And then this dude called me at 9 p.m. last night as I'm trying to go to bed. Scam caller, right? It's because Carly and I are like trying to buy a house. And so in all these mortgage companies, if you all know what a mortgage is, loan officers, whatever, stupid adult stuff, they have our phone numbers now. So I got a phone call from a guy. And he's just immediately, you pick it up, hello? Actually, no, I said, what do you want? I was really mean right off the bat, and he goes, "Well, you inquired about a home loan," and so these guys don't give you a break to talk. Have any of you ever experienced have you stayed on the phone to talk to one of these people? Okay, a handful of you. Typically, they have a script that they got to read, and they don't let you get a word in. Okay. And so I answer, and I go, what do you want? It's 9 p.m. Why are you calling me? And he goes into his little spiel, because at first I'm thinking, it's just a recording. There's no way it's a real person. He's a little spiel. And then I said something else to the effect of, like, call me back tomorrow between normal business hours. Okay, we'll call you back tomorrow. I was like, oh, it was a real person. Like, because sometimes, like, it's the auto response, right? They hear a certain type of answer, and then it immediately puts in the next auto response type of thing. But, yeah, I ruined his night, and I was happy to. So that's what it's all about. Yeah. Awesome.
I don't speak English.
That's right. Man, let me tell you, I can't stand that, but that's okay. I enjoy the agonizing trial of me just talking with somebody like that, because it's kind of fun sometimes. Sometimes I just won't let them get a word in, and I'll just ignore the phone call. No. All right, worship team, come up, please. Get ready, get set, go. Gavin just said no. Oh, no, not now. I thought you said no. Like, no, Tommy, I'm not going to play the drums tonight. And to which I would say, I don't know, I'll pick a random person to try. Who wants to try to play drums? I'm just kidding. Julie's like, pick me. Well, hey, just a reminder, there are pamphlets on the back table for summer camp. So if you have an interest to go to summer camp, make sure you take one of those so you have all the information. It's on the table around the corner, okay? And then don't forget that every Sunday we do have Sunday school. I love it when I see your smiling, bright faces at 9 a.m. in the morning, for those of you that wake up and can make it. For those of you that don't, learn how to use your phone as an alarm. Or if you're like, I don't have a phone, I'll give you an alarm clock. Because guess what? It also wakes you up in the morning. Believe it or not, you can set it for before 10 a.m. I know. Unbelievable. Yes, there is a whole wide world out there from the hours of, dare I say it, 5 a.m. all the way up to the rest of the day. Crazy. Who would have thought? You can wake up early. I know. You don't have to sleep in every day of your life. I'm just kidding. Yeah, if you're crazy enough, go for four. If you're so crazy enough, don't you even go to sleep. Just kidding. Please sleep. We all need our beauty rest. Okay. All right, everybody, real quick, stop. Everybody take a deep breath in. Take a deep breath out. All right, let's all stand. Let's worship together.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's right. You guys saw me while I was running today. And I appreciate you saying that I run fast, because it didn't feel like I was running fast. I wish I was. So I was telling Carly after my run, I went on a run today, and I know. Thanks. I use this app that tracks distance and time and all that. It gives you like all that good information and stuff. And the last time that I ran, you'll have to do the math. Today is April 20th. The last time I ran was April 28th. So, April 28th of 2021 was the last time I went on a run. But I went today. Am I going to go tomorrow? No, probably not. But maybe. Will I, though? Probably not. You want to hike? Let's go. Oh, dang. Anna just did the math. All right. Not a chance, homegirl. Oh, Carly maybe went on a run that day, and I went on a walk with her for her cool down. Did I run? Absolutely not. I can prove it to you. I'll show you my app if you need to see the proof. And you'll also see the horrible times for my mile. But I went out, and I did it. I could, but I won't. Out of a matter of principle, now I'm just not going. I'm just kidding. Here's the deal. It's going to rain. It's supposed to rain, though. Yeah, we'll talk about Tommy's fitness regimen another time. How about that? Sure, that works. That works wonderfully, actually. Yeah, sure. If you guys remember, we can talk about it, okay?
That's right.
I wonder, can you hear it? Is it raining in here? Sorry. All right, let's get on track. You guys, I want to be honest, okay? My goal for tonight was to try to talk as little as possible so that we could do small groups. So I was like, we're going to start the game in the gym super early. We're going to end it early, come in here early, do snacks early, watch the video early, start worship early, and it's already almost 7:30. How does this happen week after week after week? I guess so. I guess we're just going to have to cut out gym time from now on. Just kidding. It was a joke. I know some of you are like, how dare you, don't you dare. The rest of you are like, finally, give us something else to do. I understand. Anyways, let's get on track here. This is our fourth week in our series called Break Trail. We've been talking about the whole trail of Jesus going up to Easter, which was Sunday. And there's actually, typically our series lasts for 4 weeks. This isn't even the end of it. We still got more to talk about after this, okay? But we've been talking about Break Trail. We've been talking about hiking and camping and all the fun outdoorsy things that we all love to do, right? Just kidding. I know a lot of you don't like to do that. But a lot of you do. Raise your hand if you enjoy hiking and being outside. Good. All right. Now, how many of you love hiking in the snow? A handful of you. Okay, that's all right. For those of you that do like to hike or camp or be outside, where do you like to go to do those things? Hold on. Everybody stop. let's get real for just a second, because I hate that I have to say this every single week. But the outbursts of just talking, I need you guys to help me out, and let's work on it, and let's not just outburst the first thing that comes to our mind, okay? If you want to say something, raise your hand. If I don't call on you, like I sometimes don't, it's purposeful. Don't be offended, okay? But understand, I can't always call on you, okay? Everybody cool with that? We can all agree? We're all on good terms? Thumbs up? Wonderful. Okay. Where are the places we like to hike? Yes. Ooh, Kentucky. All right. Yeah. The woods. Anywhere in the woods. Blair. Where? Nice. Trailers. Yep. Huh? Oh, my gosh. All right. Quick story, and then I'll get back to your hands. Don't worry. I have the microphone, so I can talk whenever I want. But Brennan, their family got, what is it? Oculus, right? Oculus, all right. And so the one day, Carly and I got videos. I got to try to get these videos on the screen sometime. But we went over to do it because it's like mind-boggling. But they have this one where you climb, and you have to, like, chalk your hands and everything, all right? And so it's a VR headset, so you got goggles and two controllers around your hands, right? And so to do this climbing thing, you have to regularly chalk your hands. And if you don't, then you fall to your death, and it's terrifying, right? And so, like, they're telling us how to do it, and I'm watching Carly, and the first time that Carly, like, falls, she goes, like, and kind of does, like, one of the, you know what I'm saying? Like, when you guys fall asleep in class on your desk, and then you feel like you're falling, and you go, and you wake up your whole entire class, and now they know, like, oh, that person was sleeping, right? That's kind of what it looked like. Who? You guys, could you clean up after yourselves when you're done? But it was really funny. It was a great time. We had fun doing the VR climbing thing. Okay, where do you like to hike?
In my yard or around Jefferson, because I can't drive.
All right. You work with what you got. Huh? What is that? Is it like trails and stuff? Oh. See, things I don't know because I haven't lived here my life. The woods behind your house. I'm sure that's nice. Huh. Oh, okay. Got some options. Respect. Same. Just kidding. I love you, Carly. Sure. I'll allow biking. Are you the one that I'm constantly having to yell at? I'm just kidding. He's man, he's like, yeah, probably is him. Yes. Sure. Nice. Yeah. Around the block. Perfect. Ashtabula. Come on, Gavin. Come on. Gavin and I trudge through the river while it's flowing to catch fish. We don't catch fish, but we trudge through the river. What? On the treadmill. There we go. See, if I had a treadmill, I would run every day. I really believe I would. Not a chance. That's why we ain't got one, right? Man, one thing that I love about y'all hiking is that you're doing it, right? How many of you guys remember the first week I told you to go on a hike? Raise your hand if you've done that specific hike yet. Yes, it was a specific hike that you were to do. If you weren't here the first week, you probably missed it, and that's okay, but you just told me you went on a hike, so that's great. That's perfect. Let's identify those wildflowers. That's great. When we're... Huh? Who? I don't know what that is. Sure. Why not? Oh, pop cans. Yes, absolutely. You're outside moving around 100%. It's nice to be outside in nature, right? But sometimes we get taken by surprise. Anybody get scared by wildlife?
I got scared by
everyone. That counts. That's nature, right? All right. We're going to play a quick game. Shh. Let's not forget what we just talked about. There are going to be images on the screen. You're going to have to guess which side is the alive thing and which side is not. All right? So give me the first picture. All right, so you have to tell me, is it a dog or is it a fried chicken leg? Is it a dog or a fried chicken drumstick? All right, so we're going to guess for the alive thing, okay? So the dog is on the left, raise your hand. Dog is on the right. Donovan, respect. All right, let's see it. Oh, dog is on the left side. Everybody get it? All right, next one. All right, is it a husky or is it a bagel? A husky or a bagel? Live doggy is this side? Doggy this side. All right, let's see it. Wow, you guys are good at this. That was pretty nice. Look at how pretty the doggy is. All right, next. Now, this is a good one. It's not a frog. So you just automatically lose. You just can't win. So this is either guacamole or it's a tropical bird. All right, alive this side, raise your hand. Alive that side, raise your hand. All right, let's see it. Wow, great job, you guys. Great job. They get easier and easier. I think there's one more left, right? Two more. All right, next one. It's either, this is a good one. It's either a caramel sundae or cat. Caramel sundae or a cat. Cat for this side, raise your hand. Cat for this side, raise your hand. All right, let's see. Aww. Cats are terrible. All right, next one, moving on. Is it a dog or is it a blueberry muffin? Alive or alive? Okay, let's see. Yeah, so funny. Oh, isn't it so funny that when something is like blurred, it's kind of confusing? Like the first one, I'll be honest, the first one got me straight away. I was like, I don't know. These both look like they're chicken. And now I'm hungry, right? That's just what they both looked like. But I want you guys to think. So settle in here with me. I'm going to take you on a little bit of a journey of an experience of my own where something wasn't exactly what I thought it was. Now, don't be surprised. This happens to us regularly, okay? You've heard stories of Carly and I telling you, like, oh, Bear decided, our dog, to poop in our bed while we sleep. We didn't know it until we wake up to the smell, okay? Now, you're like, surely that can happen that often. Let me tell you, how many times now has it happened? Whatever. Pooped or smeared? Twice, okay. It's not a good surprise to think that you could just have a restful, peaceful night of sleep. Now, the first time, sorry if this is too much for you, if you can't handle poop stories, okay, but I think poop stories are hilarious, so I'm going to keep talking into the microphone about dog turds. Yeah. The first time I woke up and there was a physical turd underneath my blanket somehow. So you might think, Tommy, you done just pooped the bed. It wasn't me. It was the dog. I know, it's hard to believe, right? But I wake up, and I'm like, man, Bear just farted. It's bad. And then it's not going away. Usually, sometimes it takes a while, but it dissipates, right? Well, I get my phone out to look, and there it is. And it was on me. I was so mad it disturbed my whole night of sleep. I yelled at the dog, I threw it in her cage, and I had to take a shower. It was nasty, okay? Yeah, sure, whatever. Why not? But it was not what I thought it was going to be, okay? Sometimes you might be walking along and like, hey, oh, this eagle done just swooped down and tried to take my hat off. That's happened to me before, actually, real talk. Sometimes you might be walking down a path while you're hiking, and you might be like, oh, I'm about to step on this stick, and then that stick goes like this because it's a snake. We don't do snakes, huh? Raise your hand if you're like, snakes are gross. If they're terrifying to you. All right, I have a great snake story then. So, growing up, in my divorced house, my dad and my stepmom lived in one place, and my mother lived in another, obviously. Okay. So at the times living with my dad and my stepmom, whatever days those were Tuesdays and Thursdays and every other weekend. Yes, I remember the visitation schedule. That's what it happens. All right. Well, my dad, we were super into animals always. So for a while, we had an albino corn snake as a pet. So it was like pink and white. It was really pretty. Until one day, the snake wasn't in its glass terrarium. We couldn't find it. It was somewhere in the condo. We never found it. So we were like, all right, we got a loss. We lost the one snake. Let's get another one. So we got another one. It was even better. It was prettier, better colors. It was a little bit bigger. And one day, it wasn't in its glass terrarium. We done lost another snake. So now there were two snakes that were just gone forever. Now, did they show up at night and like slither around our faces and up our nose and out the ear? Probably, because that's what snakes do, right? Just kidding. But that did actually happen. We lost two snakes. We never found them. Who knows if they're still there in that condo to this day. And they're like 18 feet long. Wouldn't that be pretty sweet? It'd be pretty awesome, right? But, man, sometimes things happen, and we don't know that things are alive or they're dead or they're inanimate or they're animate, right? And so hopefully you kind of know where we're going with this, looking at Jesus, right? Because last week we talked all about Jesus' crucifixion, right? His death. What he died for all of you, right? And so today, we're going to be talking about Easter, right? Sunday that just happened, and about how Jesus is alive. So before we get to this, though, let's take a look back at the last 3 weeks to remember kind of what we talked about, right? Week one, we talked about what? Jesus and his friends did what? What did his friends do? They betrayed him. That's right. The first week, we talked about the betrayal, right? Judas and Peter. Peter denied him 3 times. Judas gave him up to the Roman soldiers to start the whole process, right? That first week, we talked all about his betrayal. The second week, we talked all about what? His pain, right? Jesus' pain. He was getting beaten. He was mocked. He was destroyed. He was berated. Like, all these things, right, that happened to him. So all this pain that we can feel in our lives, he knows it. He's experienced it all, right? And then last week, we talked all about his death, right? All about his crucifixion, why he had to die, the reasons he chose to die, and how the world at the time and the climate of the world saw him and decided, like, yeah, this guy's no good. We got to kill him, right? And he didn't deserve it. If you think about it, the one thing that really just always sticks out to me about that whole scenario, and I mentioned it last week too, but if you think about it, in that time, in that climate, the people of the world somehow decided that Jesus was not who he said he was. And so in the crowds and stuff, when Pontius Pilate asks, he's like, what do y'all want me to do with Jesus? What would you have me do? They yell out, crucify him. They yell, kill him, right? Somehow, some way, the people changed, right? Not somehow, some way. We know how it happened, right? This is how Satan works. This is what had to happen for Jesus' his whole plan, his whole reason for being on earth to be fulfilled. This had to happen, right? And as soon as he dies, as soon as he takes his last breath, and the veil gets torn in two, everything shakes and crumbles, and they go home beating their chest because they know that they done messed up, right? Crazy. And that's what we talked about last week. And hopefully we can understand it, like, wow, like there was a reason. There was a reason. You know, I saw a number of you response, and I praise Jesus for that because that means that he's doing something in your life and talking to you, right? He's extending, he's reaching out, and he's asking you to reach back out to him, right? To maybe take a step out in faith, right? And so tonight what we're going to talk about is what? Easter. He's still alive. Jesus is still, he rose again. Right? He did not stay buried. He did not stay defeated by death. But 3 days later, which we celebrated on Sunday, he rose again, defeating that. He's still alive, right? It can seem like kind of in that time of Jesus, right, that it kind of was hopeless, right? You think about it again. The few people that were his close friends, his disciples, the people that really like were following him and loved him, They knew that Jesus was who he said he was. They knew he was the Messiah. They saw the miracles he was doing, the ministry and the work that he was doing, and then he died. So then there has to be a little bit of doubt, right? I'm sure they probably felt hopeless because, like, man, the whole reason that we were here doing the things we were doing was Jesus, and now Jesus is gone. He's dead. What do we do? What a hopeless situation. I can relate, not into that sense, obviously, but the most hopeless time in my life was when Carly and I were married, and we were working and living at the camp, and every other week, Carly and I were going negative on our bank account, right? I had student loans to pay. She has student loans to pay. We had a car payment now, and we were making really bad money, right? Week after week after week, it was just negative, negative, negative. You overdraw, 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 reaching out to our parents to ask for help. It was bad, okay? And the thing that stuck the most was I loved that job so much. Now, I love this job even more. I do. I promise you I do. But at the time, I was like, we're going to do anything we can to stay there because I loved it. That was my place. It was it. And there came a time where Carly's parents came out to visit us and had to sit down and talk to us about it, and I started weeping. Like, I couldn't control it because I was so heartbroken over the fact that I had to start to think through, like, this isn't good for us. We may have to figure out something else. I might have to leave the job that I've come to love and the impact that I've been able to see and be a part of and all these things, and it got really crappy. Really quickly, right? We'll get back to that. Maybe you can relate. Maybe you're in a scenario right now yourself where it seems kind of like hopeless, right? Things might just be really sucky. Things might be bad. Your parents might be splitting up. Your friends might be just like disowning you and talking about you behind your back. You might be failing out of school, struggling to do well in your classes, struggling to get a job, struggling to get into college. Things can be tough, right? You might be in a hopeless situation. And sometimes in our lowest of lows and hopeless moments, it seems impossible. Like, there is no way I'm going to find a way out of this. There's no way. This situation's too bad. It's too messed up. There is no way that I am getting out of this. But Jesus is in the business of making a way, right? Jesus is in the business of making a way out of these situations, of breaking trail and creating a new path for us to follow. Sometimes we get stuck in thinking like, nope, this is the way the world tells me I have to be. This is the way the world says it goes, so this is it. This is it. Even if it sucks, even if it's hard, even if I'm crying every day, even if I don't want to be here, this is it. And Jesus is like, no. Look right there. I've done all this work for you. Literally right there. Turn your focus and maybe you'll see it. Right, so Jesus is kind of creating a new way for us. Open up your Bibles to Luke chapter 24. I'm going to try to get through this quick so we can... Oh, geez, 15 minutes. We're getting there. I do want to try to do small groups, but we might not get there. But I'm going to try. Luke chapter 24. We're going to look at... You may have heard some of this already on Sunday, whether you were here for church or you went somewhere else for church, or even if you didn't go to church at all, maybe this will be the first time you hear it, and that's okay. But Easter Sunday, what happens Good Friday, right? Jesus is crucified, he's killed, and in Jewish tradition, it's called for that after somebody dies, after 3 days, you go and visit the body, fix up the cloths, add in some nice little garments and stuff, and some scents and aromas so it doesn't smell so bad like a dead corpse would smell bad. Sorry, I know that's messed up. But Jewish tradition, that's what they did. And the third day, they visit. So the closest friends and families would go with, oils and flowers and all these things to just try to make peace, make it seem better, right? And so three women who had been close followers and friends of Jesus got up early on the third day to go and do just this, right? They get up early to go take care of all these things. And they go and they expect Jesus to be in the tomb and still be dead, right? Because that's the whole tradition. That's what they're going to do. They expect, like, Jesus is just going to be in there. We're going to have to deal with all this, right? very sad, very somber, emotional time. Very hopeless overall, right? As far as they knew, all that was left to do was to grieve and mourn what had been lost and to try to move past it. Let's see what we have to read here in Luke chapter 24, starting in verse 1. It'll be up on the screen. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise." Get goosebumps. Verse number 8, and they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other woman with them, who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling at what had happened. He marveled at what had happened. So these women, they go to the tomb, again, expecting to see Jesus' body, and he's not there. These two men, probably angels, are there, though, and they say, "Hey, Jesus isn't here. Jesus is risen." Can you imagine that? I want you guys to picture this with me. You just watched this guy, Jesus, die. Take his last breath. You were there in the crowd. You watched it all happen. Then, 3 days later, you go to take care of his body, to replace some of the cloth, to add oils and fragrances. And he is not there. What are you thinking? What are you thinking? There ain't no way that he's somewhere else, right? Somebody stole his body, maybe. Somebody did something else, and they're playing a joke, and it's a prank. No. He has risen. Isn't that crazy? Imagine the shock, even the disbelief that they may have felt in the time. They start thinking through all the things that Jesus had once said to them, all the cryptic messages, the parables, all these things that they had heard. Jesus was really alive. He really was. And it shouldn't have been a surprise because he's been hinting at it all along, right? All throughout this, he's telling them, like, "Hey, I'm going to come back. I'm going to rise from the dead. It's going to be a great celebration," right? And they still doubted. They still didn't believe. Even Peter, who was usually the first to get excited, he had to go and see the empty tomb for himself. He couldn't take their word for it. He had to see the proof that Jesus' body was not in the tomb where it should have been. He had to go and see it for himself that these women had said, "Hey, he ain't there no more. What do we do now?" Can you blame Jesus' followers for their confusion, their hesitation, their disbelief? Because it's really, if you think about it on a simple scale, it's kind of crazy to think about that Jesus, who was dead, is now not dead. Kind of weird. But it happened. In 2010, how many of you were born in 2010 or sooner? In 2010 or sooner. It's 2010 or before. Right? So if you are older than 12 years old, then that should be you, right? Were any of you born in 2010? 2009? 2008? 7? 6? Okay, so most of you probably were not old enough to remember this. In 2010, there was a disaster in the country of Chile. A mine had collapsed. A huge mine, like in the ground, in the mountains, like a mine where people dig dirt, collapsed, right? This was a huge thing. And let's see, 2010, I was 17. So honestly, I even barely remember it. Let's just be real, okay? But these miners, 33 of them, went to work like they do every single day, expected to go into the mine, dig some dirt, get out, and go home. That's the expectation. That's what they do every day. Well, this day, these 33 miners went in, and a skyscraper-sized boulder slash rock slash whatever had fell into their only way in and out of the mine. They were stuck inside, 33 of them. Limited food supplies, oxygen depleting little by little. They were trapped. 33 people who were simply going to work. I'll tell you what, one of my biggest fears is kind of exactly that, whether it's being buried alive, small spaces, inside of the ground. I just don't want to be there, right? I would not handle this situation. Okay, now these guys do this for a living. Doesn't mean they still were like, oh, it's fine, we'll get out soon. No, they were probably still terrified, right? If there's ever a moment that feels completely hopeless and helpless, it's got to be this, being stuck underground. You might think, oh, well, they rushed in quickly and started digging, and they got them out, hopefully, in a couple of days. After almost 70 days, 70 days, that's more, it's almost more than 2 months, 70 days of planning, innovating, failing, having setbacks, succeeding, a whole lot of drilling. They brought people in from all over the world, scientists, whatever, geologists, people that look at the dirt, I don't know, miners, other people. They finally had a breakthrough after 70 days of trying to figure it out. 70 days later, they come up with this idea. And it's kind of crazy. They drilled a hole. Not a tunnel. Not a garage. A hole. About the size probably of this table in circumference. They drilled a hole into the ground. One guy, he said, well, let's just build a device. We'll drill a hole into the ground and we'll send down a tube into the ground that they climb inside of, and then we'll pull the tube out of the ground with them inside. A 15-minute journey from where they were to get to the surface, one at a time. One at a time. Didn't know if it would work, if it would be successful, if they would die in the process. How many of you would vote to go first? Exactly. To go first, hey, shh, bring it in. Think about that, really, though. How many of you would actually go first? You might be funny to raise your hand and joke and say, yeah, definitely, it'd be great, it'd be a fun time. Think about it, actually. A 15-minute ride back to the surface. Do you know how deep you have to be in the ground? What if the rope snaps? What if the oxygen shuts off and you suffocate? What if the tube that they dug collapses and you die? But somebody has to go first to see, can we make it out? Can we get back to the surface? So a guy, Florencio Avalos, was the first to make the trip, one of the miners. No one was confident that he could survive, that it would work. Nobody had ever even built a device like this before. This was a trial. 33 people were down in there. So that means 33 families and friends and loved ones and close ones, scientists, media outlets, people from all over the world watched to see, man, is this guy going to make it out? Is he going to make it to the surface? Is he going to survive? So the world is watching, patiently awaiting. Will Florencio emerge from this tube system that they've contrived? Well, they watch. He comes out, safe and alive. After Florencio successfully broke this trail and said, hey, this is our option. I got to try. The rest follow. Remember, a 15-minute journey. I know 15 minutes to us isn't a long time. That's like the time from here to like Ashtabula maybe or here to Madison or to Geneva on the lake or whatever. You're stuck inside a tube about the circumference of this table. You cannot move. You are just there being for 15 minutes. Every single one of those 33 miners or 32 followed in his footsteps and took their trips to the surface as well. Every single one. He blazed a trail for his fellow miners, and it was a trail that was leading from certain death to life. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Now, there were 33 of them. If he didn't take the first leap and be the one to do it, we hope and pray that maybe somebody else would have. But guess what? It doesn't matter. They didn't have to, because he did. It's not a perfect analogy, but sometimes you think about Jesus' his resurrection can be similar to this first trip taken, right? Again, it's not a perfect analogy. But when Jesus rose from the dead, he showed all of us the way of finding new life. Everything that he said was going to happen, happened. So he's creating a way from certain death to certain life. Absolute certain life. Turn your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I'll give you a second to get there. Per usual, we look at the Apostle Paul and what he has to say on it. It'll be on the screen. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 21 to 26. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father after destroying every rule and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. That's it. That's the last one. Paul says that we can be made alive again in Jesus. He said even if we're dead, we can be made alive again in Jesus, right? He means two things by this. He means that when we die, which we all are gonna, let me say that again, when we die, which we all will one day, we're not invincible, superhuman people, we're all gonna die. Wow, Tommy, what a downer. I know, I'm sorry. But when we die, we're not gonna stay dead. Just like Jesus, we can rise again and have eternal life with God. Now, that does not mean that you physically are going to get up out of your grave and go back to life as you know it, right? But what it does mean is that you're going to have eternal life with God the Father in heaven. And so while the thought of like death might be like, phew, this sucks, of course, nobody wants to die, right? I don't want that for any of you, but listen, what I do want, I want you to meet Jesus. I want you to meet Jesus. I want you to get to heaven. I want you to experience that eternal life that is given to you. The second thing is that with Jesus, we can also find new life right here and right now. So you might be like, well, the first thing, he's kind of just saying, like, I ain't going to get to heaven and have eternal life until I die. Well, yeah, that's kind of true, but Jesus is he's offering us new life right now, too, right? Some of you, we prayed last week to forgive our sins and to accept Jesus and to know who he is and what he's done for us. He's offering that to us right now, every day. Every day you can choose to live in that new life that Jesus has given you. Why? Because he already died for you. He already died for your sins. He already defeated death for you. So that you can live in perfect relationship with God today, right now, at this very moment. Every day, you can choose to have that new life in Jesus. Every day you can choose to have that right relationship with God. But again, if he's going to extend to you, you got to reach out too. He can't just scoop you up out of the water and toss you over somewhere where it's better. You have to be willing to go out yourself. You have to be willing to extend yourself, and it might be scary. You might not know what's out there. You might not know what you're getting yourself into. But Jesus is saying, listen, I died, so your sins are forgiven. I defeated death because I rose again from the dead, so that, purposely, so that you can live in right relationship with God. I forget if it was last week or the weeks before, but I kind of talked about how one of my professors in college had mentioned, like, back in the day, the earth was in this sphere of ice and there were giants that walked the earth and stuff, and it'd be kind of cool, you know. But when God created Adam and Eve, he was in relationship with them, right? We talked about this before. And when sin entered the world, that right relationship, gone, torn in two, just gone completely. Jesus repaired that. What he did on the cross fixed that. And when he rose from the dead 3 days later, like we just celebrated on Sunday, that is when we celebrate the new life that we can have in him because of what he did. Well, we worked at the camp for years and years. I was part of the recruiting team, and so I'd go out and conduct interviews with college students who applied to work at the camp for the summer. And we always ask our applicants, like, how would you explain salvation to a 6-year-old or to a 12-year-old or to a 18-year-old? A lot of them know what they're talking about for the most part. You know, they're okay at it. I can't tell you how many times that I heard an adult my age talk about salvation and talk all about Jesus dying on the cross and never mentions once that Jesus rose from the dead. Never mentions one time that he was resurrected, that he defeated death, that he defeated sin. It's too easy for us to forget about that. Why? Because we typically celebrate it one time a year on Easter Sunday. But I'm telling you, every single day we can get up and realize, like, whew, Jesus, you defeated death. You died on the cross for my sins. I can live today in a new lens because of what you've done. We forget that. We forget about the new life that's promised to us through that. Jesus is alive, you guys. He is. And we can experience that with him. We really can. It's too easy for us in the world to make up our mind about, like, what Jesus can do, what God can do, and what he can't. We limit him too much. We think there's no way he can work in this situation or that situation or this world climate that we're in. He's not here. He's not doing anything about it. Because that's what the world is telling us and showing us, right? My question to you would be, what in the world have we been reading then? What have we been reading? Is it all just a farce? Is it just a cool story, a cool idea? No. This right here, this book, in 2 Timothy 3:16, it says that all Scripture is breathed by God, which means all this book is God-inspired. Yes, written by a human man, God-inspired. Holy Spirit intervening for this. I understand it might be weird for you to think, like, how can this book, 2,000-year-old thing, be relevant to me? How can I even know it's true? I don't know. I'm not sure I could go into some more details and stuff. But simply put, I don't know. Here's what I do know. I have faith in the Lord. I believe in what God says. I believe in what this says. Yes, there's proof of these things being true, scrolls and all these other things that honestly I don't know too much about. But you know what? I don't care. It doesn't matter to me. Why? Because I believe. Because I have the faith to know that what I'm reading is God-inspired and true. So for me to sit here and read this and know that, like, dang, Jesus was crucified. He died on the cross for my sins, but then 3 days later, he rose again. It all happened. You might be struggling to believe it, and that's okay. I understand it. It's kind of crazy. I get it. I would challenge you to read it through a new lens, though. Ask yourself, well, what if it's true? What if? What if it could be true? Changes things a little bit, right? Instead of us immediately shutting it out and saying, nope, cool story. What if we gave it a chance? What are we going to lose? This is where the pastor in me wants to say, ooh, let me tell you what you're going to gain, because it's a lot. It is so much. And so I understand it can be weird. It's a weird thing to kind of wrap your mind around, and that's okay. If you have questions, I want to hear them. I want to get back to my hopeless situation about me and Carly failing through our financial life early on in our marriage, right? And then that conversation with her parents when they came to visit us, and through my tears and crying and whining like a little baby, honestly, and not being able to see how my wife was not doing okay. Not okay in our situation, where we were living, what we were doing. She was not okay. But I was. Who cares? Is our marriage all about me? Yeah, but no. No, not at all. And so through my tears, I had to finally come to the conclusion and understand, like, we got to move. It's time. We can't do this anymore. If we do, we're going to be homeless, or we're going to get a divorce. Something's going to happen. It's not going to be okay. So we moved. And praise God that he put people in our lives in a specific order and manner in which things work out in just the way he wanted. I don't know if I've shared this story in here before, but it's pretty cool. This actually includes Miss Mandy. But many of you may know I used to work at the coffee shop. Before the coffee shop, I worked at a summer camp out in Conneaut. Not like my camp. It was a much worse experience. That's okay, though. But while I was working at the coffee shop, I was working with Mandy one day. We worked there together quite a bit. And I overheard Pastor Bill from Eagleville come in and talk to Mandy and ask, like, hey, how's Curtis? How's your husband doing? How are things at the church? And then he asked Mandy this. He said, has he found anybody to fill this position yet? Because the church was looking for somebody to fill his position. And after he leaves, I go to Mandy and I go, well, so what's Curtis looking for? Like, you know, is there any, like, you know, just what's he looking for? That started one of the best conversations that I could have ever asked for. Because of it, through months and months of me and Pastor Curtis meeting and talking and interviewing, here we are, 2 years later. 2 years? What in the world? Dang. Can y'all remember 2 years ago? I'm sure a lot of you can because, you know, last 2 years or whatever. But 2 years ago this happened, you guys. 10 years ago. 12 years ago. Wait, mental math, give me a second. 14 years ago. 14 years ago is the first time that I felt God calling me to be in youth ministry. 12 years later, 2 years ago, boom, it hits. Listen, I understand this is my story. It's kind of like, Tommy, stop talking about yourself. It's weird. I just want you guys to realize that, like, listen, 14 years ago, God said, Tommy, you're going to be in youth ministry. Today, where am I? Huh? Praise God. This is unbelievable. I just said it, you guys. I love this job. I absolutely love this. I could not dream of doing anything else with my life right now. Unless I started, like, a YouTube channel and, like, you know, I got real. I'm just kidding. I'm going to do that because I think it'd be a lot of fun. But anyways, listen. One of the coolest things was to look back on the last, because now I'm old, okay, 28, whatever. I can look back 10 years to see where I was, back 5 years to see where I was, even 3 years ago. Did I come into youth ministry right out of college? No, I dropped out of college. I had to work at a camp, be an intern, be a student. Stupid. I had to do all these things that I didn't want to do. But years and years later, guess what? God's will for my life is here. And guess what? In 14 more years, I'm going to look back to this day, April 20th, 2022, and I'm going to be like, dang, God, what in the world did you have me doing? Because it's going to be something completely different. Or it might be the same thing. Who knows? Maybe I'll be here in 20 years. I don't know. But you know what the most glorious thing about it all is? Is it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter where I am tomorrow, the next day, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. It doesn't matter. You want to know why? Because God is still going to be God, and I'm still going to have a relationship with him. God is still good. He's always going to be there. He's always going to be good. The Bible is always going to be the Bible. Amen, hallelujah. Like, it's unbelievable. All because Jesus is alive. All because Jesus rose from the dead, defeating death, defeating sin, so that we can be made right with him. Amen? Just like when Pastor Curtis does it, I say amen. You can say amen back. Amen? Amen. Absolutely. Jesus is alive. Again, I'm so sorry. I'm over on time. No small groups. Yet again, we're going to make it happen. I promise you this. Even if I have to cut out the rest of the night and we just do small groups for an entire night. I'm just kidding. We'll figure it out. But listen, I'm going to close in prayer, and here's what I want you guys to do while I pray. I want you to just think about, like, man, do I really believe that Jesus is alive? Do I really believe that Jesus rose from the dead? And if not, I want you to ask yourself, why do I keep coming to youth group every week? Why am I here? Am I here to socialize? Am I here because it's an escape from home? Am I here because my friends drag me along? Am I here because my parents kick me out the door and force me to go? Or am I here to earnestly seek God? Am I here to grow? And listen, if you're not there yet, I'm not saying you got to stop coming. I want you to come forever until you graduate. Then you got to go. I'm just kidding. I don't care what the reason is. But I want to try to challenge you to get you to the point where you're coming because you are seeking God. To where you're coming to youth group because you want to grow. You want to serve. You want to be in relationship and build relationship with other people. So go ahead and close your eyes and just think about where you are. Where do you fit in that? Maybe it's scary for you to take that step, to take that leap, to go out in faith and be like, man, I got to change my mindset. To go out in faith and realize, like, man, my social aspect doesn't matter. To realize, like, man, I really don't have to go to youth group just to flirt and look cute. But, man, I'm going to go to youth group to pray. I'm going to go to youth group to grow. I'm going to go to youth group to build my relationship with God to be the best that it can be and surround myself with a group of people who will help me get there. So, Lord Jesus, I just pray and ask that you would help us to realize and know that you're alive, that you did rise from the dead, just as you said you would, and that because of that, God, we can have a relationship with you, that because of that, our relationship with you and with God the Father is restored, and it's perfect, and it's there. We just have to extend and reach out. So God, would you challenge us and grow us to step out in faith, to go into some uncomfortable circumstances. Just like the guy who had to be the first one to ride the tube up out of the ground for a 15-minute journey that was not certainly going to save him. It could have killed him, but he did it anyways. So God, challenge us. Have us challenge ourselves, self-assess ourselves, and ask ourselves, what if? What if? What have I got to lose? So God, would you help us? Would you grow us? Would you challenge us this week and the weeks to come, Lord? We love you. We pray these things in your name. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, I hope you have a good night. Again, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry we didn't do small groups. We'll get back to them, I promise. I hope you have a good week. And see you Sunday, and if not then, next week on Wednesday. Don't forget to get your camp flyer on the back table if you need one. Now go home.